Welcome to Algebra 2. This is section 2.4. We're modeling with quadratic functions today. All right, so we've covered really a wide range of topics regarding quadratic functions and parabolas. And really, this spans two chapters of our work in this class. It'll be chapter 2 and chapter 3 as well. But I really hope that we're starting to put some of the pieces together and see how, first of all, these parabolas can be used in a variety of ways, but also how the correlations between the variables and the transformations and stuff. Those are really good connecting pieces of information that should hopefully help us understand the concept very, very well. All right, for our introduction, the function in this graph over here approximates the yearly profits for a company over time. And you can see they have not labeled any of the years on our axis or any of the profits for that matter as well. But they did give us the function, and it works in variables. There are no numbers there, but it's showing us that it's opening upward. We can see a sort of parabolic shape there. Let's work with that. Is the value of A positive, negative, or zero? Well, A is our leading coefficient, and we know that if the graph is opening upward, A has to be positive. All right, the next one says, write an expression in terms of A and B that represents the year T when the company made the least profit. So if our yearly profit is on the P-axis here, the lowest point, it appears to be somewhere around here. And we can see based on our function, it is quadratic, so we know that that lowest point is the vertex. Well, it's a little bit different now. Instead of our input being x, it's t, but here we're trying to find t equals, right? We're trying to find some time. So we can kind of adjust our x equals negative b over 2a, right? That told us the axis of symmetry. It also told us the x value of the vertex. We can modify that to work for t here. And luckily, we still have variables a and b, so t equals negative b over 2a is that time. All right, the next little bullet point here. The company made the same yearly profits in 2004 and 2012. Estimate the year in which the company made the least profit. Well, if it made the same profit, it means it had the same height. So let's just say that this height, and again, they don't give us any years, so we can just kind of, I hate to say the word assume here in math, but let's just say that here, these two places that have the same height, maybe this is 2004, and this is 2012. And we can see they have the same height, so that indicates the same profit. That's what our height axis, the p-axis, is measuring. Well, if those two have the same height, then the lowest profit should be in between those two, based on the symmetry of the graph. So all I want to do is average 2004 and 2012. And we get 4016 over 2, which is 2008. And that makes sense. We probably didn't have to go through our average formula there, but we may have needed to do that if this were a different problem. The idea being we're trying to find the midpoint between 2004 and 2012, kind of working with the symmetry of that function. Assume the model is still valid today. Are profits currently increasing, decreasing, or constant? Well, present day would be over here on our t-axis, and you can see that our graph is on the rise. So if that parabola were to continue, the profits are currently increasing because the graph is gaining height as we move further in time. Okay. All right, so again, just kind of, I mentioned this in the introduction, we've covered a number of different properties here. Hopefully they all tie together very nicely. Now what we're going to try and do is take data and try and set up a situation like we saw in our introduction, where we had a graph that we could analyze and we could predict about the future. So we're going to learn how to set up, using data points, how to set up quadratic equations, how to set up parabolas to evaluate. All right, so we're going to cover a couple different methods. The first one is the algebraic approach, and really, there's another algebraic approach where if we know like a focus and we know a directrix or we know a vertex, if they give us key pieces of information, we've kind of worked with those so far this chapter. However, what if we're just given a set of data points and we don't know what those data points are doing on a graph? We don't even know if it makes a quadratic function. Well, if we have such a situation, if the data is given so that our inputs are equally spaced, so here you can see for the example I've given you, the inputs 10, 15, 20, 25, they're all spaced 5 units apart, then we can look at the outputs. Oh, here. Those are our inputs. Here are the outputs. Our outputs will have the same second difference. So we look at what's the difference between first and second outputs. Second and third, third and fourth. Each time we are taking the first one minus the second one. And then we do the same thing. That was just our first run through finding differences. If we do that a second time, if the differences remain constant, then we know we have a second degree function, a quadratic function. Okay, now if that works, we can take any 3 data points to set up a system of equations. You said in geometry, I'm sure you remember this, that it takes 2 points to define a line. Well, for a parabola, we need 3 points to establish the curvature of the parabola. So we could pick any 3 of these data points. Here they just grabbed, it looks like the first 3, or no, the 10, 20, and 30. And you can see it's a wise choice on their part. 10, 20, and 30, pretty easy to deal with when you put those into an equation. But we set up 3 equations that will give us a system, which can then be solved to find the actual quadratic function. This is a very tedious process. Don't freak out. We're not going to have you do a lot of these on your homework, but just to kind of show that this stuff can be done by hand, which is a very, very rewarding experience. Now, if we don't have equally spaced x values, or we're allowed to use a calculator, we used a linear regression in chapter 1. The calculator also has a quadratic regression. So we'll enter our points in the stat menu. We'll probably plot the points somewhere in there just to see if it looks like a parabola, sorry, then, you know, it might look like a line. We don't know, but see what those points look like. If it looks like a parabola, then we can use quadratic regression, and then we can use the graphing menu, the y equals menu, to see that graph and then analyze it from there. All right, so our first example here, you can see we've got a point x, y that our graph passes through, and then we've got a vertex. H, k are the variables that we use there. Well, it says to write it in vertex form, and we're in good shape because we know that vertex form is y equals a times x minus h squared plus k. We already know the h and k, we already know an x and y that work. However, we don't know this a value. So we're going to have to run through this little formula twice, once to find the a value and then once just to set up our final answer. So my y value, negative 15, equals a, that's what we don't know, times the quantity, my x value, negative 7, minus h, that's minus a negative 5 squared, and then plus k, which is plus 9. All right, if we're solving for a, I'm going to subtract the 9 over to the left-hand side, so I have negative 24 equals a times negative 2 squared. Negative 2 squared is a positive 4, so I'm going to divide both sides by positive 4, and I get negative 6 equals a. Now we can write our equation, right? We need those variables x and y to make it an equation. Y equals negative 6 times x minus negative 5 squared plus 9. We do include the h and k here. We only want to equate our inputs and outputs, our x's and y's, in our final answer. And let's just see if that makes sense, right? You know, we have these transformations that work for us, can really, really help us out here. So we've got the point negative 5, 9, Right here, it passes through the point negative 7, negative 15. Way down here, you can see it has to be a pretty steep downward parabola in order to do that, to have this vertex and pass through that point down below. So our equation looks pretty good. We've got the left 5 and up 9 in our vertex, and it's pointing down steeply as it needs to do. So we've got some reference, some ways of checking our answers to make sure that it makes sense. All right, example 2, here we want to write the equation of the parabola in intercept form. Okay, remember that's y equals a times x minus p times x minus q, where p and q are the two zeros of that function, the two x-intercepts. So here we've got x-intercepts of 9 and 1, that's our p and q, and it passes through the point 0, negative 18. So just like before, we need to solve for a, and then we can go about writing our equation. So y equals our unknown a times x minus p times x minus q. So negative 18 equals a times negative 9 times negative 1. And negative 9 times negative 1 is positive 9, so I'm going to divide positive 9 from both sides. And I find that a equals negative 2, so I know my equation is y equals negative 2 times x minus 9 times x minus 1. And it's in intercept form. If we wanted to put it into standard form, we would foil these together and combine like terms. Let's see if this makes sense. We've got a downward facing twice as tall parabola. So we pass through the point, I think that's 18, passes through that point 0, negative 18. It's got x-intercepts at 1 and 9. It sure looks like our parabola needs to be twice as steep to accomplish that. So a steep downward facing parabola does fit logically with the answer we've come up with. All right, example 3. This is going to be the long one, so you may want to write small in your note packet or in your notebook if you're following along. A baseball is thrown into the air. The table shows the heights of the baseball, that's our y-axis in feet, after x seconds have gone by. Write an equation for the path of the baseball. Find the height of the baseball after 5 seconds. Well, this is a problem that we are told to do by hand. That means that in order to verify that it is, in fact, a quadratic function, we would need equally spaced x values, and you can see that, yes, there's a difference of 2 each time. Well, now what we need is our second difference in the y column to come out equal in order to ensure that we do in fact have a second degree polynomial, a quadratic function. So that 6 minus 22, well, that's negative 16. 22 minus 22 is 0. 22 minus 6 is positive 16. Okay, let's check our second difference now. That was our first difference. All right, negative 16 minus 0 is negative 16. 0 minus 16 is another negative 16. So, confirmed, we do have a quadratic function. Now what we want to do is set up a three-variable system of equations. Let's change the color here quickly. A three-variable system of equations that use three of these points. And I'm just going to choose the first three. You could choose any of the three points there. But what we want to do is set up this y equals ax squared plus bx plus c. Set that up with each of our inputs and outputs. Now we're solving for a, b, and c. Those are the variables that we need to know to construct our equation. All right, so the first one, y, 6, equals a times x squared, well, that's a times 0 squared, plus b times x, that's b times 0, plus c. And if you ever have an opportunity where 0 is the input of one of these and you're setting up a system of equations, choose that point as one of your three. You can see it definitely made things easier when our input was 0. All right, the second one, the output 22 equals a times x. Now our input is 2 squared, so that's a times 4 plus b times 2. All right, our x value, our input is 2 plus c. And then our third point right here, the output is 22. That equals a times, now our input is 4 squared, 16, plus b times 4, plus c. So now we've got this three unknown system. We've got 6 equals c. We've got 22 equals 4a plus 2b plus c. And we've got 22 equals 16a plus 4b plus c. And since we had that one point that had an input of 0, chances are it won't come out this clean every time. But man, that's nice because we can use substitution to set up an equation that is 2. Or set up a system that is 2 equations with 2 unknowns. So 22 equals 4a plus 2b plus 6. Well, that, if I subtract 6 from both sides, tells me that 16 equals 4a plus 2b. And then my final equation, when I substitute 6 into that one, 22 equals 16a plus 4b plus 6. That becomes 16 equals 16a plus 4b. Again, just by subtracting 6 from both sides. And let's change colors one last time here for our final step. I wanted to combine these with elimination. The b variable looks pretty easy to eliminate. I'm going to multiply this equation by negative 2. And then rewrite it down below. So negative 32 equals negative 8a minus 4b. And if I combine these two equations together, my elimination method takes form. Negative 16 equals 8a. And then the b's cancel out. Divide by 8. We'll find that a equals negative 2. And when we did these problems earlier, we said that, hey, when you have two equations with two unknowns, we usually put a box around those, if you remember this from chapter 1. Now we can substitute this a value into either of these two equations up above to find the b value. I'm just going to use the top one, 16 equals 4 times negative 2 plus 2b. And now it's just a matter of solving for b. Add 8 to both sides and divide by 2. So I find b equals 12. So remember, we're trying to find the height of the baseball after 5 seconds. We need our equation to do that. We're anticipating it to be somewhere between 22 and 16, right? If my input were 5, it would be somewhere in between those values. But our equation will let us find that for sure. So our equation is y equals negative 2x squared plus 12x plus 6. And all I did was took that standard form of a quadratic and plugged in the a, b, and c values that we found. Now if I want to find the height after 5 seconds, I've got y equals negative 2 times 5 squared plus 12 times 5 plus 6. That's negative 50 plus 60 plus 6. That height is 16 feet. So again, a lot of writing, but hopefully something that is definitely manageable for us. Very cool. This second difference concept is something that's very, very neat. All right, and our final example, the table shows the results of an experiment. Testing the weight in tons that can be safely supported by ice that is x inches thick. Again, we need to write a function that models the data and figure out how much weight can be supported by ice that is 22 inches thick. Okay, so we're wanting an input that is somewhere in here, And so we're expecting it to be between 25 and 40.6. That's how we can tell if our function is appropriate. Well, to do this, I'm going to need to pull up the calculator. All right, and we're going to use that quadratic regression. So the first thing we want to do is go to the stat menu, and we want to edit our data. Now list one is going to be all of the x values, all of the ice thickness measurements. So we've got 12, we've got 14, not 44, 14, we've got 15, 18, not 48, 20, 24, and 27. I'm going to toggle over to list two. Here's where I want to make sure I'm matching up my ice thickness with how much weight it can support. So 3.4 tons is my first output, 7.6 tons. Then we've got 10.0, 18.3, 25.0. There's our 40.6. And lastly, 54.3. And we just want to check and make sure that each of our inputs is matching up with an output, otherwise this will not work. Now let's check and see. Our x values did not have equal spacing like they did in our last example. So I want to just plot those points and see if they actually kind of resemble part of a parabola. So you can see, well, or probably not see, above the y equals it says stat plot. We're going to hit second. Y equals, and then we're going to hit enter for plot one. Hit enter again to turn that plot on, and we want it to be a collection of points. So then we're going to hit the graph key, and nothing appears, but that's because our window is only going to 10. Our first X input was at 12. Now there's a nice feature called zoom stat. I think it's number 9. And if we hit enter, it will zoom to fit our statistics. And you can see it looks like it could be a line, but there's definitely some curvature happening there, so it certainly does look like it could be a piece of a parabola, although you probably could make a decent best fit line with that data as well. All right, well now we want to find our regression equation. So what I want to do is, in the stat menu again, we're going to go to calc, and option 5 is quadratic regression. And we'll hit enter, and you can see there it gives us our A, B, and C values to fit up to fit into our quadratic equation. All right, and now most of this work is going to be done on the calculator. So now in our Y equals menu, we're going to go vars, option 5 is statistics, go over to equations and choose our regression equation, and it types that in without any rounding whatsoever. And then we'll hit graph one more time. This will include our points and the function that we put in. And you can see we definitely needed a parabola to fit those points very well. That looks like a nice regression equation. Okay, now how much weight can be supported by ice 22 inches thick? Our input, we want to be 22. We want to know what is the value of that function when our input is 22. So this might be new. I don't know if we've done this in this class yet, but if you hit second trace, you can see it says calc up above. We can find the value of a function. So we're going to choose option 1, and it's asking for the input x equals. We want our input to be 22, and if we hit enter, you can see the output is 32.359. So they've been rounding to tenths. We could say 32.4 tons. All right, here's a look at your assignment. Pay attention to the one problem that we want you to do by hand to practice your systems, you know, and kind of keep that process fresh in our minds, and then a couple using the calculator like we did in this last example as well. So that does it for section 2.4.